Even though I have the rotor balanced now with that machine screw and a couple of nuts, the rotor came with kind of a wobble in it, but I'm hoping that that will not be too serious, as long as the overspeed control furling system works, should be okay. So I'm using a 3/8 inch diameter bolt right here for the axle. The head of the bolt is just right in terms of keeping the inner ring and the outer ring from separated. You wouldn't want, for example, a washer right here, because the outer ring then would find resistance against the washer with respect to the inner ring. So it's important that you have a means of securing the rotor so that the inner ring only is in contact with the bolt here. Likewise, on the back of the rotor, I have a barely visible down there, a 3/8 inch nut. Now I drill the threads out of that nut so that it will offer, so it could go over the actual bolt itself. In addition to that, I have a nylock type of nut securing the bolt in place, and I think that should work out pretty good. So I found through experimentation that these bearings don't like any compression there at all. They don't like any thrust type of force on them, so you need to let them float free, basically. So to do that, I found it necessary to make up a block of wood to hold the shaft of the rotor, which is in fact a 3/8 inch bolt, in place so that I don't get any movement like this, which I would get, any severe movement like that, which I would get if I didn't have a block of wood there. So the block of wood keeps the bolt essentially horizontal, and at the same time I don't have the compression forces on the bearings, which would slow the bearing, offer a lot of resistance and slow the rotor down. And this results in having the rotor run free. All screws and nuts are locked in one form or another, either with lock washers or a locking compound, like Loctite type of stuff. And that applies to everywhere there's a nut or a bolt. In the case of my counterbalance weight here, I have two nuts there. They're locked against each other, but also I have some locking compound on that. Here's a nylock nut right there, for example. So everything is protected in terms of separating due to vibration. That applies to the tower as well. I used either nylock nuts and or locking compound to hold everything in place. Everything will vibrate in this, especially true of wind turbines, so that's been taken care of. So the windmill is just about ready to be installed. Just a quick review on how this thing works. The kit came with the intention of having the rotor mounted on this shaft right here, so that it would move over from here to there and would run on the bearings right here. The problem with that is there's no way of controlling the speed of the rotor, and in the kind of winds that this will be exposed to, it will likely destroy itself in short time. So the modification that I put into this is I welded a hinge on here. The other half of the hinge is right here. so that when the wind is strong, the tail will stay and be in position according to the wind direction like this. When the wind is strong, it will hinge the rotor like that, taking it out of the wind. The tail is still staying in the wind, aligned with the wind. And when the rotor turns like this, it's very little exposure to the wind and the speed of the rotor will slow down. And then when the wind slows down, the spring will return the rotor to the normal operating position. So that's the general principle behind the speed control. It's an idea that's been used for probably 150 years in the American farm windmill. And those are water pumping windmills. But here, this is a decorative, ornamental type of machine. But like I say, without some means of overspeed control, it wouldn't last too long in the kind of winds that we get in this area. So the windmill is installed now, and have a fair little breeze, but not enough yet to cause the furling of the. Running quite smoothly. You can hear a little bit of a rattly type sound, primarily from the bearings, but other than that, it looks good. Looks like the yaw bearing tail right here. And I think the main motor bearing also failed. So that's after about 12 hours of running. So we had a major windmill failure overnight. I installed it about 3 o'clock yesterday afternoon, and it looks like it quit about 12 hours or so after that. It appears right now as if the yaw bearing as well as the rotor bearing, both of those have failed, so I'll know more a little bit later.
wind speeds overnight weren't excessive, from what I can understand, possibly 50 kilometers an hour, maybe 30 miles an hour, but I should have been able to furl and survive under those wind conditions. So clearly, right now, it appears that just the quality of the air is probably the main problem.